This is a talk which is the one and only cloudy talk, maybe. So I'm trying to focus on the cloud these days, so to deploy RDMA in the cloud. And with that, we are working on providing a efficient data store for serverless computing. And I will tell you why we are doing that and tell you where we are. The agenda is as following. First, I want to ask ourselves why we need serverless computing. I don't know if you are aware of that. Serverless computing, who heard about serverless computing before? Okay, one. Not that many. So I don't have to show results with that. That's good. I will tell you the current limitations and challenges of serverless computing, and then dive into the real problem, how to handle ephemeral data in serverless computing, and how to integrate such an ephemeral data store into the serverless computing environment, propose a prototype integration, and give a summary. It's about a decade ago, or maybe even 13 years from now ago, that we saw this move from managed clusters to cloud computing. And the promise by then was quite rich. So the promise was that virtually we will have infinite compute resources on demand. We don't have to upfront commit ourselves to the infrastructure. We pay just for using what we use. We don't pay for the whole managed cluster as before. And with that, we will end up with very large systems because we can share those clusters among many users. And with that, we are ending up within the economies of scale, so we will be much cheaper when providing the same services as we would run them in a managed cluster in-house. And two more promises are we will have simplified operations for shooting up jobs, running them, because everything is virtualized. We don't have to care about real machines. We are just initiate servers by virtually bringing them up, and with all that, we will have a higher hardware utilization within our data cluster because we are multiplexing the workloads of several users on our hardware. But we have to ask ourselves if this is really simplifying the operation, because from managing physical resources, we are just moving to managing virtual resources. The user is still in charge of bringing up the systems, still in charge of thinking about the heels of the system, still must see that it is running a matching system and must maybe do system upgrades themselves and so on. And with that, since a while, maybe since 2 years, people are saying, let's get rid of servers. We don't need servers anymore. We don't want to know what servers are doing. We just want to write our function for the cloud and let the cloud execute it, and we get the results. And from the serverless system point of view, that means that the system or the framework itself brings up the servers when they are needed. It does the scaling of the resources. It does a kind of auto configuration of the running system when it is needed. It is fault tolerant. It does the logging and maintenance, and the user doesn't care about this anymore. This sounds really nice, really promising, because the user doesn't have to set up and maintain its cluster anymore, and he gets really fine-grained sub-seconds billing because he only gets charged for the seconds his function is running within the cluster. And for the provider, the advantage is that they can even more optimize its his resource utilization. So in a nutshell, there are three main things which are differentiating cloud computing from serverless computing. First of all is the abstraction of executing a piece of code instead of first allocating resources on which to execute the code. Second one is paying for the code execution instead of paying for a resource allocated to execute the code. And last not least, and this is where we are focusing on today, is the decoupling of computation and storage. They scale separately and are priced independently. So that means that the provider is not only bringing up servers, the provider is also bringing up the needed amount of storage on demand. Next slide is a simple, very simple example of a serverless function. You see on the left side, you have real-time events which are coming in and which are triggering a user-defined trigger. With that, the cloud function gets executed. It writes it result out to something like a database, and the result of that operation becomes immediately available, and after that, the whole system magically disappears. The function goes to rest, it just goes away. This is currently being used for mainly for short running event triggered jobs like web application backends, like real time data processing, like transcoding of images if you are loading your new Facebook picture. Then at the same time a small thumbnail gets created with a cloud function, and then the whole thing disappears. But the question now is, can we use this nice serverless computing idea also for long running and more complex jobs like machine learning? That means can we, while preserving the serverless model, make use of the possible massive parallelism when we are running as many functions as we have spare resources at a certain point of time? And can we compose multi-stage serverless executions which is reflecting changing resource requirements, like here in this picture? In the first stage, you need lots of you can massively parallelize things. In the next stage, you need just two functions, and in the final stage, you are summarizing and preparing for output your results within one function. The challenges for doing that for complex operations is basically threefold. One is the efficient instantiation of those functions, so they must shoot up in a few milliseconds. The second one is the efficient and fine-grained coordination between those function and stages. You have to maybe share a collective operation or something like that, and this is not easy to implement with this kind of stateless functions. And last not least, the efficient communication of the data between the stages becomes the main showstopper when it comes to performance. So the next picture shows how a MapReduce job would run on a managed cluster. You know that. I will just shortly go over that to lay the ground and to mark the difference to serverless. You have data input. The data comes into the systems. It gets executed in a map phase, for example. And if that map phase is completed, data are shuffled again and ending up in a reduce function, which gets executed, and you are done. Right? And the interesting thing is here that the ephemeral data, so the data which are transferred from one phase to the next phase, are mostly read and written locally, and they are exchanged directly between the two stages. So there's no man in the middle which must keep a state between these two phases. And it looks very different when you think about serverless computation. You are starting with just nothing, right? And then when the data come in, you basically have to instantiate your systems. You bring the functions alive, which are doing the map job. They have to read the data from a shared medium, from a shared data store. They execute the map phase, and then they disappear. And in the next stage, we are bringing up the next resources to run the reduced jobs. New functions are getting instantiated. They are reading the data from the storage, and they do the execution. So that means there's no direct communication between tasks, and tasks are short-living because they are stateless. And read and write of all data is from distributed storage. And these stages cannot, or these functions cannot directly pass state and data function from one to the successor. With that, the efficiency of the execution of a job highly depends on the storage service itself, so on the performance and the elasticity of that storage service. Regarding performance, if we really want to run complex jobs, we are ending up with the demand of microsecond delay access at one time for small objects like function parameters which gets passed from function to function, but also large chunks of data. And here is an example here. That's a CDF of three different workloads: TPCDS, machine learning, Cocoa, and PageRank. And you see that there is a whole range of different object sizes which are being created and must be stored within such a intermediate data store. The next requirement is elasticity. Think of such a ephemeral data store as a service which is having different kinds of memory, so which is exposing different types like DRAM latencies, like flash performance, like block device sizes which you can store. And if you want to make fine-grained billing reflecting used resources, you end up with the need to dynamically decide which storage service you need for each stage of your job. So you could have a job which needs lots of block storage because it's not latency critical, but it's lots of data which have to be brought in the first stage. And you need some flash memory and maybe some very high-speed DRAM to execute your job. And you could have another job which is just needing much less data but needs more efficiency, which needs less delay to run timely. And there could even be jobs, and this is the basically the main advantage of serverless, that during the runtime of your job, you have growing and shrinking requirements. In the first stage, you need less memory, less storage than in the second stage, and in the third stage, you need again less memory, and in the fourth stage, you just need some flash memory to store your final results. And the good thing is, if you can support that, you can basically keep the bill low because you are really using through all your stages only the storage which you really need, right? And now the question is, which data store we should use for those ephemeral data? First idea, of course, and this is what typically happens today, is an object store like S3. It's very good for large data sets, but it's inefficient for small data. You could think about key value stores like Redis, Memcached, AWS, ElastiCache, which is very good for small data sizes, but it's inconvenient to store larger data sets because there is a limitation typically for the value per key, so there's an interaction and the application itself must chop up its objects to fit into that key value store. And it's typically also implemented in DRAM, and it does typically not dynamically scale. And with that, of course, we looked what we have in our pocket ourselves. And since we have developed Apache Crail a few years ago, and I think I have presented this 2 years ago, we have a store which fits the bill better, we think, because it has the lowest possible delay for small data sets. It has the highest possible throughput for large data sets. It is multi-tiered, so we can mix all types of storage, like DRAM, like RDMA-based DRAM access, like TCP-based DRAM access. We can integrate NVMe-based flash memory, and we even have block store, and we can integrate this all within one namespace. And we can also explicitly tell the store where to place the data, so we could, when we know where the next function is running, could place the data which are needed by the next run of functions, place the data close to the physical systems where these functions are running. The only limitations we are currently having that this Crail store does not dynamically scale down. This is something we have to fix, but we don't have it yet fixed. So with that, for the first time, I mentioned the word RDMA because Crail does RDMA, and with that we want to use the RDMA capabilities of that data store. We want to integrate RDMA connectivity into the picture of serverless computing. There's a pro and a con for that. The pro, of course, is that when we are running RDMA, we are having a low delay access to the data store. We can have arbitrary size object because we can read and write in one go. And we have a nicely low to zero CPU load during accessing the data store. But there is a contrast side to that, and this is basically can be wrapped up within the world of the RDMA setup costs. So the functions, when they get instantiated, they would have to create objects like QPS, protection domains, CQs. They would have to do memory registration and all that. And at the server side, we also would have the cost of setting up a connection to the client. And with that, it seems to be a strange idea or something really challenging to use RDMA within the serverless, stateless world. So we have basically the contradiction between a serverless world and a stateful RDMA communication and resource model. The development environment where we are testing our ideas is basically simple currently. We, as a runtime environment, we are running Kubernetes, which is managing containers. As a cloud function environment, we are using Apache OpenRisk. And as I said, as the ephemeral data store, we are using Apache Crail. We have a really small system setup currently. We have four physical nodes. We have them connected via 100 gigabit Rocky, and we have some Samsung 960 NVMe cards. Now the big question is, how can we get RDMA into the picture of Kubernetes, into the picture of a world of containers, of systems which are coming up and coming down all the time. And we thought about that for a while, and we came up with a few, basically five different ideas, and I'm going to carry you through all these ideas in the next few slides. The first and the most obvious idea would be to put the function in a shape that it can directly talk RDMA to the ephemeral data store. That means we would have a native RDMA integration with the function. We would have microsecond delay, fast communication. We would have zero copy. At the Qantas side, it is not acceptable to set up the RDMA resources for each and every instantiation of such a function. And another roadblocker currently is that RDMA devices cannot yet pass through into Kubernetes Docker containers. So there is currently no way to make that happen. There is a potential solution if we would fix that pass-through of the RDMA devices to the virtual system. We could have warm container caches, which are basically stay alive when a function terminates, and if the same function gets called again, would to revive the function and not shut down the connection in the meantime. The next idea is quite simple. This is having a proxy system within Kubernetes, which basically speaks RDMA to the containerized ephemeral data store, and at the same time talks via normal TCP/IP stream to the various containers running the various functions. The pro of that, of course, is that the serverless framework does not need to integrate with RDMA, and there is currently no framework, no serverless framework which does this integration. The next advantage is that we don't have to keep any persistent state within the function container, and the proxy can become persistent, so the proxy can basically survive the whole runtime of a multi-stage job without disappearing. The contra to that is that there's a performance penalty, of course, because we have to copy the data within the proxy between TCP and the RDMA stack, and we have those data two times on the wire. And with that, the next idea is, of course, to co-locate the function and the proxy container on the same physical host, and to have shared memory between the function container and the proxy container, and have that shared memory RDMA registered all the time, and the proxy container can live up for the whole time of the job, and the containerized functions can come and go and just memory map the shared memory and talk to the data store. That would mean we are doing kind of zero copy with a trick of memory mapping. The disadvantage of that is that each physical host should have one proxy container, which is not a big disadvantage to our feeling. The next idea is to have the storage client a service of the functions container itself. So we bring up the container, and the container contains the client for the ephemeral store, and at the same time it brings up the function. That means we don't need an extra proxy, and the client is rather close to the function, and the function can directly speak to the store without implementing RDMA functionality. And the disadvantage of that is that the lifetime of this store client is limited to the lifetime of the container, and we can of course mitigate that with having warm containers being around for quite some time and hoping that they get reused by the next function. And the most elegant solution would be to have RDMA storage exported as a attachable persistent volume. So this is a concept within the world of containers, basically saying that you can mount a persistent volume to your container, and that persistent volume is part of the Kubernetes runtime, but not part of your container. What is hidden here is the is basically the communication overhead between this containerized storage service and the function container. So that reason being that typically a persistent container is implemented as using the local file system of the host the container runs on to share data. That means we would have to implement something like Fuse or some user level file system which is basically reading from the RDMA device and pushing to the local file system and then reading back and writing back from the container world. So with that five choices, we ruled out the first one. So we are currently not looking into a direct cloud function attachment to RDMA because it seems to be unreasonable because of the overhead, the sheer overhead of bringing up and bringing down RDMA resources all the time. And we are concentrating on the proxy solutions and the persistent volume variants. The persistent volume variant currently looks too complicated, so we are not pursuing that currently. We will look into that maybe later. And we started our evaluation with the simplest case, which is the remote proxy case. So this is this setup, how we are running the system currently. We have a containerized Apache Grail instance, controlling a RDMA DRAM tier and an NVMF tier. And we have physically distributed the store itself. So we have basically data nodes on all machines which are exporting some local NVMe flash and some local DRAM to the Grail data store. And we have a single containerized proxy storage living within the Kubernetes environment, which runs the storage client to talk to the data store, and which basically maintains the RDMA connections to the Grail name node, and that proxy accepts connections from remote containers via TCP and basically transforms the inbound storage requests from TCP to RDMA, and it is ready to move closer to the functions container itself. In the next step, we will look into using shared memory to share the communication or automatic communication between proxy container and function container more efficient. So this is our first setup. We have a MapReduce sorting algorithm implemented within functions, and we are sorting 100 gigabytes, and we are using two storage tiers, the NVMF tier and the DRAM tier. We have four systems, and we iterate over the amount of reduce functions, starting with one reduce function up to 256 reduce functions. The next page should show the results, and this is what happened. I was waiting for the results until this morning, and then I decided to put in this page. So this is a crash of the JVM, and we found out that basically it is the huge page support which is missing in the JVM, and we have to fix that. And if you want to look into results which are quite similar, I can refer you to the Pocket project, which we did with Stanford University, which is basically doing a very similar approach, but which is not using RDMA but plain TCP/IP. Then you can see that we get some decent results. I can't tell you numbers here because we are in a different project, and the numbers I have seen so far within our project are they have a too high variance, and they don't want to have numbers in the web which then stick forever and which are not true. Last slide, the conclusions. We think serverless computing is a promising technology. It's the next natural step after cloud computing because of the ease of programming and of the automated resource management and of the concept that you pay only really for the resources you have used. There are many unresolved issues, and we have looked into one of them, and this is the efficient management of ephemeral data. So we are currently looking at this aspect, and we have a integration underway where we're using Apache Grail for that, and we have other related activities going on, which is the scaling down of the Apache Grail store, which is not yet possible, and we also look into this into the efficient provisioning of distributed communication primitives served by the ephemeral data store. That's all. So questions? No. It's too off from HPC, right? Okay.